Hi everyone. In today's video, we're going to talk about records within Java. Records are something that was relatively newly introduced into the Java language, and they are a really useful feature when it comes to something that is a read-only or immutable data container for information. Previously in Java, in order to create classes with this purpose, you had to add a lot of boilerplate code, but now with records, it's a whole lot simpler. And it even future-proofs your code, and it's more readable. So what's there not to like, right? Let's go ahead and get into IntelliJ, and I'll show a few examples of how you can use a record in your code. Today's project is going to be called Record Demo. Now, one other thing I do want to mention about records is that I did say they were a new-ish feature of the language. They were added in JDK 14 as a preview feature, and then they were previewed again in JDK 15. And then they were officially added to the language in JDK 16. That's a lot of versions, right? I know, but I got one more for you, JDK 17. 17 is the one you really want to use if you're going to use a record. And the reason for that is because 17 is the long-term support version that has records introduced. So when Oracle comes out with the next long-term support version, we can move to that. But in the interim, if you want to use records, I'd recommend you're using JDK 17. All right, so what I'm going to do here is I want to create some code that uses pre-JDK 14 logic. I'm going to create a class called fullname, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to add some logic into here, and I'm going to demonstrate the issues with it, and then I'm going to convert this over to a record and show why a record was better in this particular case. So this fullname class is going to have a constructor called fullname, and it's going to take a string argument of first name and a string argument of last name. And then we're going to have our private data members. And then we're going to set these equal. Let's not do any sort of validation for now. And in this case, I'm going to override objects to string method. And instead of using the super implementation, what we're going to do is we're going to say first name, add in a space character, then add in the last name. And we'll go ahead and test the code here, make sure that this looks good. We'll use my name. And we'll see if this is working. All right, looks good. So as expected, we're calling the toString method whenever we are wanting to render an object reference into a string with a println function or with anything else that would want to convert a reference into a string. So we call the toString method and we get this value here. The other thing I want to do is, let's say I make a name here, and I make name 2, and I want to see name 1 dot equals name 2. Equal, and not equal. And here we see a little bit of weird behavior where we're creating a new reference, but we have exactly the same data fields, but the default implementation of the equals method from object returns false in this case. I want to override that. So in this case, what I'm going to do is I'm going to override equals from object. So now at this point, I'm going to go in and I'm going to create an equals implementation, which takes a little bit of thought. First, what I'm going to do is I'm going to compare object references, then I'm going to do a downcast, and then I'm going to look at some data members. So I'm going to go ahead and write some code here. All right, so this looks like it should do the trick. First thing we're doing is we're looking for object equality with the reference. If the references aren't equal, we check to see whether we are a full name object, and then if we are, then we compare the values here. Let's go ahead and test out the code, see if this works better. All right, that looks better, and we'll go ahead and test a negative case, make sure that looks good too. All right, cool. And now we're actually doing something that we shouldn't be doing, and that is we are overwriting equals without hash code. So we are violating the equals hash code contract. So let me fix that. And I want to override hash code. And the reason we want to do that, the gist of the equals hash code contract is when you are changing the relationship of equality between objects, you need to also make sure that the hash codes match, because if the hash code and the equals relationships don't agree, then you're going to have an issue with any sort of class that relies on hash codes, such as hash sets, hash maps, those sorts of things. When they go to look at the equals operator, there are certain guarantees that you normally would expect with collections that you wouldn't get if you violate the equals hash code contract. So let's not do that. So instead of using the default implementation, let's use objects.hash. And let's use this.firstname, this.lastname. Okay. This shouldn't change the result of our code at all, and I need to fix a few things here. What is this private final? Okay, that's better. We'll run this code, and this should be equal this time. All right, cool, so this looks good. But one of the main problems with this is a lot of boilerplate code for something that should be pretty straightforward. And another problem with this is whenever I want to extend this full name class to include additional data members, I have to make a whole bunch of changes. Sure, I only have to change it in this one file, but I have to change it in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 places. Ugh, yuck. What if I needed to add middle names in here, for instance? Let's say that I want to allow full name objects to now have a list of middle names. Let's say I want to add suffixes. Now I need to add that in all these different places, and my class gets bigger and bigger, and my logic for the equals and hash code methods get bigger and bigger. It just isn't really all that good. We want to be able to simplify this and have cleaner code. Well, there is a solution for that. And in this case, where I know that I don't need to change any of my data members and I have what I call immutable data, I can use a record and I can make this much simpler. So instead of calling this a class, I'm now going to call this a record. I'm going to delete all of that code. And instead, what I'm going to do is I'm going to define my record parameters up here. I've got a string called first name and a string called last name, except I want a lowercase l. Okay. Now if I go back to my code, you'll notice that everything seems to be working the same way. Let me double check it. All right, interesting. So we can see that the equals method is doing the same thing that we expect, where it's overwriting what's an object. The toString method, while not exactly what I had, still gives me some really useful information. I can see the first name and last name fields, and I can see that it is a full name type. Honestly, I kind of like this better if I were to use this for any sort of logging information. If I have an application and I want to log all these full name objects, I would kind of prefer this over my toString implementation. And I converted 30 lines of code-ish into one. So that seems to me like kind of a slam dunk. Now, what is a record doing under the hood? Well, a record is essentially something you can use when you want to guarantee data immutability and you want to have a kind of a tuple type relationship if you put on a Python hat for a second. And what it's really useful for is when you want to have like an API endpoint and you want to have this API return some information and you want your caller to be able to process it, or let's say that you want to look at some data from a database. Records could be very useful in situations like that. And they have a few additional other features too. They have what's called a canonical constructor. And that is, I basically define this full name here. And instead of now having to need to copy this parameter list like you would normally, I can use that syntax, and the parameter list is automatically defined for me. And add validation here. So now instead of just blindly passing in values to my constructor like I was previously, if I wanted to, I could validate the fields of my record in this canonical constructor. And I can do so in a way such that I still have pretty clear syntax of what I'm doing. And this sort of thing is quite useful. Let's say just for kicks that I want to throw an exception, a legal argument exception, if first name equals null or last name equals null. Let's go ahead and do that. And let's not make it an illegal argument exception. Let's make it a null pointer exception. And I'm going to be bad and not explain why the null pointer exception is getting thrown. I'm just going to show this as an example here. I'm going to add parentheses where we should have them. And now here in our class, I'm going to remove this information. And now I'm just going to do that. And as expected, we get the NPE, the null pointer exception, where we would expect to see it here on line 6 within our full name constructor, specifically the canonical constructor. Now, let's say that I want to access my data members. Well, records generate getters for your data members, which is pretty straightforward. What you do is you do name dot. And you can see that we have these first name and last name methods. These are based off of these names right here. And what they do is they are getters for our immutable data fields. So let's say instead of printing out the full record, I want to do name.firstname. And let's say that I want to get rid of this extra logic. I want to allow null again. If I run this code, I get null as expected. And if I run this code, I get my last name as expected. Cool. So what else can you do with a record? If you really wanted to, you could override toString. Not sure I'd recommend it. It kind of just depends on what you need it to do. You can override equals and hash code if you really want to. But again, I think more often than not, the default implementations are plenty good. We can also do static methods. And what we're going to do is we're going to say this is a string with a single space in it. For the purposes of this, I'm not going to foolproof this code. In fact, it's going to be very brittle, so don't use this as an example. I'm just going to give a quick demonstration here. What we could do is we could say we'll make a string array result equals full name dot split. Like that, and then we're going to return a new full name with the first result and then result one. So if we demonstrate this here, comment that out, and now we can do full name dot from. Full name, and let's do first name this time. And as expected, we do get the first name. Again, I wouldn't recommend the code I just did in any sort of production environment because it is not safe. I'm not doing any null checking here. I am blindly assuming that I have two elements in this array. Not good code, but I hope that it explains the concept without going into the details of specific hardening of implementation. All right, one other thing we're going to do is you can add additional constructors outside of the canonical constructor. So let's make another constructor. This time I'm going to have just one argument. I'm going to say last name. And what we want to do in this case is we want to use the this syntax like we would when we call constructors normally. And I'm going to have a null first name and I'm going to pass in the last name. And let's go ahead and make sure that this looks good. what I can do here is full name. Let's go ahead and say new last name. And then I'm going to print the first name, which as expected is null, because when we call this constructor, we are calling the canonical constructor, and that is a parameter of null for the first name, and the last name is the last name we pass in. So if I were to change this to last name, now we get the last name we're expecting. Now, one thing that I want to touch on really quick before I end this video is records are really good for the situations where you need them, but you also need to be careful that you don't try to make something a record when it shouldn't be a record. So for instance, if you don't have data immutability as a consideration or a guarantee, then you might need to stick with something like a POJO, a plain old Java object, where you have regular read and write access to your data. Records are really good for read-only access or when you can guarantee immutability. If you cannot guarantee immutability, then you're going to want to look at something else. And what I'd recommend is, if you don't have immutability, you should ask yourself, why not? Because kind of like how I like to use the final keyword a lot, I like to assume that I'm not going to change something after I've said it, rather than assuming that I could change it, and maybe actually I don't. That's something that you should be thinking about when you're writing your code, and I err on the side of liking data immutability rather than opening up the possibility of too much write options, because then that also makes your code more thread safe later on, which we can talk about in future videos. That was an introduction to records. Hopefully that was useful for everyone. I haven't seen records used too much in code yet, but I think partly the reason for that is because they weren't introduced until Java 14. And a lot of people are honestly still on JDK 8. And if they're not on 8, they're probably on 11. There are some people who are on 17 or, as the time of this recording, all the way on 20, which just came out in March of 2023. But really, a lot of businesses want to stick with long-term support versions. So if they're using records, they are really using Java 17 as of now. So records are a really good thing to use in code, but I think that it's taking a while for people to incorporate them more into their libraries. And I think after watching this video, maybe you'd have some ideas of areas that you could write it in your code. And maybe you'll help the community move forward and start using some of these newer features. Now, a very important thing about records to remember is that they assume immutability of their data fields. If you can't guarantee immutability and you have to change your data fields out, then really what you're looking for might be a POJO, plain old Java object, or something to that effect. And with that, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please do smash that like button. If you haven't had a chance to subscribe to the channel yet and you're enjoying the content, please do hit that subscribe button. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you again for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.